Would it surprise you to know that Henry Ford tried to create a utopia in South America simply because he wanted cheaper rubbers? Because he totally did. Hey guys and gals, I'm Brandon, the futuristic utopian. Today we're talking about Fordlandia, Henry Ford's, that's right, the car guy, utter failure of a utopia in the Brazilian rainforest. So this is the first outright failure of a utopia that we've discussed in this series. Granted, it's only episode 3, and one of the two prior episodes was an introduction episode, and we didn't really discuss a utopia in depth in that one. So really, it's the first set of two that we've discussed an outright failure. But I digress, because I believe that in many ways, we can learn more from our failures than our successes. So let's begin. Henry Ford was many things. Much has been said on him as a person, as an entrepreneur, and a historical figure. Not all of it good, but that's not the point of this video. There's a lot of content out there about Henry Ford the man, but less so about Henry Ford the utopian. As I said before, Henry Ford was many things, but indifferent wasn't one of them. He always had opinions and always needed to take action. He had a lot of ideas, some great, some not so great, and some downright terrible. This is the story of the latter. We all have a few memories of Henry Ford that we've picked up through the years, most likely dealing with his implementation of the assembly line to build automobiles or his introduction of the $5 per day wage. Which was a big deal at the time. I mean, I spent $5 just this morning on coffee. However, with each new revolution that he brought into the American working psyche, he exerted more and more control over those who worked for him. After revolutionizing the working environment of early 20th century America, his policies took a sharp turn, or, more likely, kept pushing harder in the same direction. After Henry Ford implemented his assembly line and $5 per day wage to increase both production output and efficiency, he then instituted a strict police state-esque culture at all of his factories to increase production and efficiency even further. You see, Ford wanted every single one of his workers to be a model American, both at home and at work. Talk about not having a work-life balance.
I'm also going to need you to go ahead and come in on Sunday.
If you weren't a model American, at least in the eyes of Henry Ford, then you wouldn't qualify for the $5 per day wage, or worse yet, you could be fired. The criteria to be a model American? For starters, your home had to be neat and tidy, your children healthy, and you must be thrifty. But even if you didn't meet these criteria, I mean, how would Henry Ford even know, right? Well, surprise, Ford thought of that too. And his answer was the Ford Sociological Department. The department was in charge of monitoring workers' living conditions, monitoring their health, their children's health, and their spending habits. The department was there to ensure that workers were upholding Ford's idealistic values both at home and at work. Each worker had to be a choir boy in public and private, and there was always an authority figure from the company watching over its workers. After the early success of Ford's Model American policy, and a desire, as always, to increase efficiency and productivity while simultaneously lowering cost, Ford then set his sights on Brazil. Ford realized that if he could decrease the cost of acquiring the raw materials needed for his assembly line, then he could ultimately reduce the overall cost of the finalized product. In the 1920s, most of the rubber that Ford used was sourced from Sri Lanka and was monopolized by Britain. There was essentially no other way for Ford to get rubber other than going through the Brits. As such, the possibilities discovered by the immense amount of rubber trees located in the Amazon basin didn't go unnoticed. For years before Ford's involvement enterprises began tinkering with ways to export rubber from the Amazon basin to other parts of the industrialized world, workers swelled to the basin following the promise of never-ending work in a booming industry. Oftentimes, though, the conditions of the new rubber plants that were built and the houses that the workers lived in were quite poor. And it was found that the trees couldn't be planted too closely together, lest parasites destroy them, vastly hurting the number of trees that could actually be planted and harvested for rubber. Thus, the towns all along the basin began falling into disrepair. The basin was not only destroyed physically, but economically. Enter Henry Ford. Ford saw Brazil as perfectly opportunistic to build a better version of his model American factory. Ford intended to bring American values of hard work, personal accountability, cleanliness, and structure of life to Brazil, believing that what he built in Michigan was so groundbreaking that it would work anywhere. And so, for $125,000, wait, what? What a steal! Ford had rights to operate on 5,625 square miles of land in the Amazon basin. 2 years after receiving the rights, Ford tasked Einar Oxholm to begin construction of Fordlandia. A city of sorts was built. In it were warehouses, factories of production, and housing for the Brazilian workers. A separate neighborhood in the city was built for the American staff that worked in what was now dubbed Fordlandia. The American section had running water, and the rest of the city had water that was provided by wells. And over the next few months, a hospital was built alongside a school and a sawmill. Policies and regulations were put into place, which all inhabitants had to strictly adhere to, chief among which was the prohibition of alcohol. None of the planned development of the site happened as quickly as Ford wanted. You see, clearing out 5,000 square miles of Amazonian rainforest actually proved to be a difficult task. Go figure. And soon, problems like boredom-inducing work and menial tasks causing people to quit surfaced in Fordlandia, thanks to the backbreaking labor of forest clearing. And with the rise of disgruntled workers came the rise of disgruntled local press, and ultimately to an outbreak of violence. Tensions between skilled workers and manual laborers ran high in the early part of Fordlandia's existence, and one could guess the rising tensions were helped in no way by the separation of classes via living conditions. So when skilled and manual workers crossed paths in the cafe, arguments were bound to start. In December of 1930, an argument broke out between a supervisor and a brick mason. The workers, as so often is the case, rallied behind the brick mason and began vandalizing the unfinished city. They destroyed equipment, generators, even their own homes. The violence was quelled only after the Brazilian military was brought in. While violence is never ideal, this instance did push Henry Ford to appoint a new city manager, Archibald Johnston. Johnston evoked peace by actually working on finishing Fordlandia before starting production. Wow, what a great idea. Housing for workers was completed, roads were paved, and then construction on access roads to the river for transportation of goods and raw materials was finally finished. It can be inferred that much of the demise of Fordlandia was due in large part not because of faulty ideology, but rather the lack of promised fulfillment. When workers began arriving in Fordlandia, they were promised houses on par with what Ford created in America. They were promised food and an overall increase to their standard of living. However, in reality, what many Amazonians received upon arrival were shacks to live in, and food that had spoiled due to the lack of access roads to the city from the river where the food arrived. To really drive in this point, it's important to mention that construction on the actual city of Fordlandia didn't even begin until 2 years after Ford had the rights to the land. Workers arrived at what they thought was going to be utopia, but instead were harsh conditions in the middle of a Brazilian rainforest. This divide between expectation and reality unfortunately set Fordlandia on a path of overpromising and underdelivering, a path that ultimately led to its failure. But finally, with Johnston at the helm, the local workers were no longer expected to be satisfied with less than ideal conditions. In fact, they now helped to build the city in a manner that represented Ford's original vision. A dance venue was erected, a movie theater that showcased top Hollywood films was built, and even the hospitals were improved. That listing was not necessarily in order of importance. It is safe to say that morale was never higher at Fordlandia than at this point. However, the city still had one huge flaw. It wasn't producing any rubber. So much of the workers' time and energy was spent on building the city that rubber production essentially took a back seat to entertainment. When focus shifted to rubber output, much of the original problems associated with cultivating rubber in the rainforest, i.e., disease and pests, resurfaced. After spending so much time quelling the outrage in the city, the key economic value of the city, the very thing that would give the city the ability to be self-sustaining and continue to exist, was ignored. I mean, how do you forget that? All of a sudden, the costs of actually running the city vastly outweighed any economic output that the city was producing. To help with perpetual frustrations caused by the lack of having any healthy trees, Ford brought in a botanist named James R. Weir. Weir's relationship with Johnston was strained, to say the least. Weir began implementing numerous planting methods and even called for the construction of a second plant to be built in the land that Ford owned. Yet, a year after being hired, Weir left Fordlandia without informing anyone, and he never returned. To say that the failure of Fordlandia was due entirely to circumstances within the Ford Motor Company's control would be a lie. While a good case can be made that regardless of the political landscape of the world in the mid to late 1930s, Fordlandia was destined to fail, at least some credit must be given to the impending threat of World War II. Traditionally a pacifist, or perhaps for other reasons, Ford was vehemently opposed to American involvement in World War II. He did eventually agree to build airplane engines for the British government, but for much of the early part of the war, Ford tried to stay away. That was until the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. Once the attack was over, Ford put aside his Monroe Doctrine-esque ideals and ramped up manufacturing efforts. Ford Motor Company plants were used by military personnel and switched focus to produce jeeps, tanks, and armored vehicles for the Allied forces. Records show that by the end of the war, Ford had built over 86,000 aircrafts, over 57,000 airplane engines, and over 49,000 military gliders. The production strain that the war took on the company, coupled with Henry Ford's worsening health, caused Henry Ford to bequeath management of the Ford Motor Company to his grandson, Henry Ford II. Upon the takeover, the younger Ford began selling underperforming assets as a way to cut costs. And just take a guess as to what was underperforming. So perhaps the least shocking cost-cutting measure was the reselling of Fordlandia back to the Brazilian government for a fraction of what Henry Ford had originally purchased it for. The American workers who populated Fordlandia immediately returned home to America, while the locals stayed. Ford's desire to quote-unquote civilize the Amazonians, born no doubt out of compassion, proved to be extremely arrogant, something we could all learn from today. There's a difference between helping those we view as less fortunate than us and them wanting our help, or even needing our help. Indeed, it's almost admitting they are inferior, and if they would only do things as we do, see things how we see them, then they would be happier, more useful, more productive, more fulfilled, more etc. And that's regardless of the seemingly altruistic thoughts that these actions may stem from. Whether or not, probably not, Ford should have attempted to enter into the Brazilian rainforest is the topic of much debate. By the time he actually got around to building his utopia in the Amazon rainforest, Britain's stranglehold on rubber production began to diminish. So Ford's main reason for building in the Amazon, which was cheaper rubber, was already being accomplished elsewhere. So was Fordlandia truly an attempt at utopia? Or was it just a misguided dream by an American businessman who thought he could tame the allegedly untamed land and people? Quick refresher on the criteria of utopia. 1. Societal independence. 2. collective desire to better the society, and 3, continual improvement. When Ford bought the Amazonian land, he did have full discretion to operate his city however he saw fit. There's no doubt that Ford had full reign over his city. Well, at least in theory, that is. While Ford technically owned the land and could develop it however he liked, he didn't have complete independence from Brazil. His utopia still had to pay taxes and obey the law. Perhaps even more so, the Brazilians who worked at Fordlandia almost certainly didn't display any type of societal independence. For them, this wasn't a utopia far away from home. It was merely a better place to work located inside their own country. While Ford could almost do anything he wanted to with this project, he couldn't force his workers to completely disenfranchise themselves with Brazil, and instead dedicate their lives solely to Fordlandia and its progress. Inevitably, the culture of the Brazilians seeped into the culture of Fordlandia, manifesting itself into a society that still had to obey some societal norms of its workers, lest bloody riots or, worse yet, coups erupt and production halt. This leads us straight into Fordlandia's ability to garner a collective desire. Certainly, this was an absolute failure in practice. But at least he tried. I mean, Ford wanted a rubber factory that was built in the same nostalgic vein as his production facility in Dearborn, Michigan. A mini American factory town in the Amazon rainforest. One that would replicate the ideals he believed in back home in America, proving that American work ethic and ingenuity was the ideal road to progress anywhere in the world. Well, simultaneously lowering cost and increasing profit margin on his cars. Meanwhile, the factory workers that came over from the U.S. undoubtedly had their own motives for taking their respective jobs at Fordlandia. Self-interests such as money, pride, recognition, promotion, traveling most certainly played a part in all of their decisions for moving. While it is undeniable that some overlap of Ford's and the American workers' goals existed, i.e., when the company did better, their prestige in the firm was elevated, their paychecks probably increased, and their recognition blossomed. The interior motives of American workers were, without a doubt, too different from Ford's to lead to a unified direction and desire amongst the two factions. Which leaves the Brazilian workers, the vast majority of which probably didn't care about the profit margins or the bottom line of the Ford Motor Company, but rather sought income for living, eating, and caretaking of their families. No matter how much Ford thought he could institute a collective desire for the good of the society in his workers, no matter how much he thought his American factory town way of life would grow on the local workers and have a positive impact on them, they did not, quote-unquote, drink the Kool-Aid. As for continual improvement, well, we could simply say that Fordlandia no longer exists, and as such has no way to improve, and therefore isn't improving, and as a result has failed this criteria, but that would be anticlimactic. So let's go back to when Fordlandia was operational, and explore what was happening in the town. Yeah, it wasn't perfect, yet as time went on, the company did plow resources into it to help improve the standard of living and working conditions. It even added entertainment venues, added more jobs, and better housing. Fordlandia truly was perpetually improving as it aged. If only we could have improved its name. So, even if it did fail, when it comes to this criteria, I'm a little lenient. Ford knew as soon as his town opened that it wouldn't be perfect. That was the point. It would live, and it would grow, and it would breathe, much like its inhabitants. Slowly, it would turn into what it needed to be for the company. And even if it didn't, progress was still seen month after month. Well, everyone, that's Fordlandia, but what do you guys think? Was the utopia worth attempting? Why or why not? Leave a note in the comment section down below. And I know that there's a lot of thoughts around Ford and his attempt at utopia, so please try to keep it civil. Don't forget to follow me on social media, leave a like on the video, and if you enjoy this series, then check out some of our other work. I'll see you all next time, and remember that the future is out there.